God is great in my soul. Oh, my God is great. He's greatly to be praised. God is great in my soul. Yes, my God is great. He's greatly to be praised. God is great in my soul. Oh, my God is great. He's greatly to be praised. God is great in my soul. We certainly thank and praise and magnify the God of our salvation. He has allowed us to be in the number one more time. And certainly we are grateful for his loving kindness. There's a passage in the book of Psalms, and it reads that his mercy endureth forever. Aren't you glad this evening for that enduring mercy of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ? My God, my God, my God. The Bible tells us it's not for his compassion, his mercy that is renewed every morning. And if not, we would be what? We would be consumed. So we're grateful this evening for that mercy of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Can we say praise the Lord? We have been talking for quite some time in regards to transforming the mind. Transforming the mind. And we're still on that subject this evening. I certainly want to say to those of you that are on campus this evening and also on our social media, we are certainly appreciative that you have taken out of your time to be with us this evening. I'm very serious about this particular subject because it can enhance our lives, and certainly in every segment of our life, any environmental setting. And if we take the Lord very seriously, it certainly means that things will change. Things will change. I think the church itself will stand. Jesus Christ made a statement that is so profound, and I say it this evening. He said that he will build his church, he will erect his church, and that the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. It meant that the grave will not prevent him from establishing that church. And this has been stated over 2,000 years ago, circa. And what I'm saying tonight, my brothers and sisters, it is vitally important for us that lay claim to Christendom that we hold up our end, might I say, of the deal. We've asked God to do a number of things for us, and he has never failed. And these last times that there are so many hearts and minds are changed. But if there's ever a time for the church to stand and the church to members to run for their lives, it is incumbent upon us today. I think there's a move, there's a wave that is going on, and the enemy is doing all that he possibly can to deceive and discourage the church of the living God. Can I say this to you? You know, I'll get move a little further. Would you consider a painter that doesn't paint? I would certainly say that the consensus would certainly say that that's not possible. That's not possible. Could you consider a fisherman that never catch fish, but he's a fisherman? I know we got some fishermen in the house tonight. Now, I'm not talking about Captain D's and Long John Silver's. That doesn't count. Could we consider a person that has a profession that is a plumber, and you hire their expertise, and they come to your home, they can't tell the difference between cold and hot water. Of course, I'm saying some of these things to illustrate a particular point, and that is that there's something about Christians that is affixed to them. Christians go where? Go to church. All right? At least I, when I started years ago, that's what I thought, you know. And not only that, but I want to also say that there are certain things that are affixed to the Christian lifestyle. That is church attendance, that is prayer, and that is when we come into his courts, we come into his courts with thanksgiving and praise. There's something about us that particular atmosphere, it energizes us. Am I talking loud enough? In such a way that the Bible tells us, and I want you to listen to this as we go along tonight, that Christians feed on the Word of God. It is a thing that gives them faith. It's a thing that enables them to go through the challenges of life unscathed. Am I talking loud enough tonight? Unscathed. So it permits them to accomplish the task that God has given them of the Spirit of God that resides in them. Can we say praise the Lord? And that is what he's going to reward us for. He told us that we should be the lights of the world, and also we should make disciples of men. I think the same employment that he gave his apostles in the early, in the primitive church, and perhaps that was pre-conversion, and that was that Jesus said that I will make you fishers of men. And we are in the fishing business. I say that metaphorically, by the way. And so it is imperative of us, if we're going to be rewarded by the Lord and we are in a spiritual kingdom, that we must do spiritual things. Many individuals cannot multitask. When I say multitask, having the ability to do several things at a given period of time. Can we say praise the Lord? Look at your neighbor and say it's going to pay off after a while. Brother Williams, I'm certainly delighted to see you. Amen. It's, come on, put your hands together, Brother Williams. We used to sing a song years ago, said, get your time in. Payday is coming after a while. Can we say praise the Lord again? I want to say this is coming to you from Bethany Apostolic Church in the heart of the city of Evansville, Indiana. We are located geographically at 212 Mulberry. We have a website, and that is BethanyApostolicEvansville.org. Our email address is BethanyApostolic212@gmail.com. We would love to hear from you. And even tonight while you're watching this on YouTube and Facebook, if you want to put something in the chat, go ahead and do that. We'd like to respond to you as well. Our services on campus and also on Facebook and social media is every Sunday morning at 11 a.m. Tune in to us. We'd love to have you. And on every Tuesday at 6 in the evening, we have our Bible study. We have a food pantry that is open every third Monday from 6 to 8. You're cordially welcome. Come down and if there's a need that we can supply, we certainly will do so. Can we say praise the Lord again? So we're grateful for you. And by the way, every last Sunday, we have what is called a soul food community dinner. I want you to know that it's very delicious. I gave reference to those that made those barbecue, I think it was barbecue rib tips. I said, now you know how preachers like chicken. I was ready to give up chicken for that because it was certainly very good. Can we say praise the Lord again? So we say thank you, thank you. And also we say welcome, welcome, welcome. I had started a part of transforming the mind. And an under-subject we talked in terms of last week was, why do people have or behave the way that they do? I want to try to finish this portion this evening. I made a statement, and I would certainly hope that our listeners would allow this to percolate in their mind. And that is, prior to being introduced to Christ and going through the processes of spiritual activity, this means that he has strategically placed us in a place that we can hear the gospel of Jesus Christ. In its simplicity, it means the good news. It means Christ has come to liberate, emancipate those of us that are tied, tangled with sin, shame, and debauchery. He has empowered us, he's enabled us, because of his death on the cross of Calvary, that has overcome and defeated the enemy, that being the devil, and has opened the door for us to walk across the threshold and be a part of this vast community that is called the kingdom of God. And if we say kingdom, obviously it means that there is a king that has a domain. And that is none other than Jesus Christ. He is our king. He is our Lord of lords. He is Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end. He's the first and the last. He is that potentate. He is our king. He is our Lord. And those of us that ascribe to this discipline that is called Christianity, this means that he has called us out from the world. The Apostle Paul gives reference to this in the book of John. Did I say Paul? I meant to say John, in John chapter 3, where he says that you must be born again. And many times, my brothers and sisters, this becomes a problem, because how can we be born again? And he says it must be born again of the water and of the Spirit. And he gives reference and says, that which is flesh is flesh, and that which is spirit is spirit. And for us to get a working knowledge of that, let us understand that the flesh means that we have been born by blood, by when a man and a woman comes together, and of course you have a baby. But the spirit, what does it mean by the spirit? Born again in the spirit. And it gives reference to particular things, that you can't enter the kingdom and you can't see the kingdom unless these two particular things are done. And not only are they done, but they are done under the auspices of the Holy Spirit. And I would certainly encourage you to read Hebrews chapter 4 and verse 2 at a time of leisure. So this means that the Spirit has born or birthed us into a spiritual kingdom. Can we say praise the Lord? And tonight, my brother and sister, it stands to reason, if we are born in a earthly environment, it certainly means that what? We have to learn. Is that right? We have to learn. Now, it's a terrible thing for us to make the assumption that anybody could be born out of utero and not have the ability to learn. So we have to learn. We have to learn how to function in this physical world. Is that correct? Well, it certainly stands to reason that if we're born of the Spirit, we have to learn how to function in a spiritual kingdom. All right? And so this means that something has changed in us. In us. What has changed? What has changed? The Apostle Paul, in his journal, makes us privy in Ephesians chapter 2, in particular, in verse 1. He says, you have been quickened. This simply means you have been made alive. All right? Now, alive means that something obviously must have been dead, or we were separated from the Lord. And we were separated from the Lord because we had this old, corrupt nature that we acquired from our federal head. That was Adam and Eve in Genesis chapter 3 in particular. Now, keep in mind, all of us that are born into the world we have this corrupt nature. There is something inside of all of us that stands in opposition toward the eternal God. All right? There is something that causes us to be in enslavement. All right? Paul says this, he rehearses this to his hearers, his readers in Romans chapter 7. I would certainly encourage you to read that at a time of leisure. In other words, Paul said, there was something inside of me, but I wanted to do good, but that which I would do, I do not. So he is struggling with something. Now, of course, there are many Bible teachers. There are many that will use the terms of hermeneutics that will tell you that this is specifically talking about Paul. He is self-disclosing. He is becoming vulnerable. But I like to say that this is more than just looking at the Apostle Paul. This is the plight of all humanity. This is something working in our personal, individual humanness. And it is in contrast or contrary to the purpose and will of God. Can't we say praise the Lord again? So he reveals to all of us prior to conversion or pre-conversion that there was something inside of us. And if you look at that very closely, he was saying that this is like a slave master. All right? And if it is a slave master, it means you and I have nothing to do in terms of stopping what the slave master wanted us to do. Right? And that old nature was what? It was an old nature that was susceptible to sin. And of course, sin is a violation toward the will and rule and authority of God. Bible says, the soul that sinneth, it shall what? It shall die. It shall die. Can we say praise the Lord? So for us to live, it meant that God somehow had to do away with that corrupt nature that is inside of us. And let me say this real quick. Real quick. Now I'll say my little thing and I'll go out of the way real quick. So the nature of a bird is a what? The nature of a bird is to fly. In any given situation or environment, the nature of a bird is to fly. You grab him, he's moving your hands. No, he's not trying to get away. He's just doing what his nature calls for it to do. And that is what? That's to fly. And the nature of what? The fish? The nature of the fish is what? To swim. Catch him with the pole and bring him out of the water and he's doing like this. Well, he's not trying to get away. He's simply doing what is in his nature. He is trying to swim in an environment that is not indigenous to his nature. So therefore, how can we make this illustration an application to apply to what we're talking about tonight? It means when you had a corrupt nature, you did corrupt things. It was your nature to do wrong. Your nature was intact. It will always do what its nature dictated it to do. Can't we say praise the Lord? Let me give you another illustration as I take my time tonight. I was around the age perhaps of 16. I worked for Kmart. And I had a gentleman I used to ride back and forth to work with. He was a student at the University of Indiana State University there in the city of Terre Haute. And he always wanted a pet. And that pet was a cheetah. And I thought to myself, man, what do you want a cheetah for? And he just wanted a cheetah. Oh, I thought the cheetah looked good, you know, beautiful animal. Is that right? But the cheetah had a nature of being what? Wild. Well, Pastor Frazier, you could certainly domesticate the cheetah, right? But you don't know when the cheetah might decide he's wanting to be what? Wild. You follow me? So what I'm saying tonight, my brothers and sisters, that you cannot domesticate this corrupt nature of ours. There will always be a time that it would want to do what it does. So it had to be what? It had to be what? Changed. Had to be changed. It had to be transformed. Can't we say praise the Lord? So this is what the writer conveys to us when Paul speaks in his essay, his journal, as he writes to not only to the church at Rome, but it is distributed around the Christian community. And he says, transformed by the renewing of our mind. There is a possibility that our minds can be transformed, and it's done by the work of the Holy Spirit. So, therefore, my brothers and sisters, I want you to know tonight that if the person has never been born again, hear what I'm saying now, never been born again, or might I say spiritually domesticated, hear what I'm saying? This means that that nature somehow or another, because it is corrupt, it is in opposition to God, it will always do and operate according to its nature, and the nature of humanity is the sin. Is the sin. Now, if you have a question, you can write those questions down. We'll give space and time for those. It is the nature is to sin. It is the nature to be a violator. Even the Apostle Paul, as he writes to the church community of Ephesus, he said that Satan is the prince of the power of the air, and also said it is the spirit that operates or in the children of disobedience. What was the sin in the Garden of Eden? They disobeyed God's law. When God put a prohibition on that tree that was in the midst of the garden, that tree of knowledge of good and evil, God said, the day thou eat, that thou should surely what? You're going to die. You're going to die. But they became violent because they disobeyed. And as a result of that, being born again in the spirit inside of us, this enables us to obey God. Those that have not the Spirit of God, the Bible tells us in Romans chapter 8, the Bible said they are none of his. And of course, this day and time, put your seatbelt on when I say this, this day and time, everybody is a child of God. But that's, according to the Bible, that's not correct. That's not correct. Correct. Maybe a creation, but they're not a child of God because they have not the Spirit of God. So, those that have never been regenerated, those that have never come to Christ, those that have never repented, those that have never been baptized in his name, those that have never been filled with the Holy Ghost, you still have the spirit of that old corrupt nature. Are you still with me? Now, on the other hand, those that have accepted Christ through hearing the gospel that has penetrated their mind intellectually, spiritually, cognitively, and they have accepted Christ according to the scripture. After Peter preached that dynamic message on the day of Pentecost, Acts chapter 2, they cried and said, men and brethren, what shall we do? And he said, repent and be baptized, Jesus Christ, for the remission of sins, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. And note what he says here. It is for you, for your children, is that right? And for many, as the Lord our God shall call. Can we say praise the Lord? They that gladly received him, oh my, they were baptized. And they were initiated into the family of God. That's in your Bible. It's in Acts chapter 2. And I encourage you to read that and then allow it to percolate in your mind. Secondly, since now they are in the church, the Spirit of God is inside of them. And when I say Spirit of God, it's the Spirit of Christ that is inside of them. Romans chapter 8. It's inside of them. You know what I'm saying now? Now, this means since the Spirit is there, then one has to learn how to function, how to operate in this new what? Environment. Now, let's not forget that the old corrupt nature is still there. It's still there. It's still there. All right? The only thing that has changed is the spirit has now been awakened. The spirit now is activated when the spirit was dead. And when I say dead, I'm only talking about separation. Ephesians chapter 2 and verse 1. So therefore, hear what I'm saying now. The spirit now is awakened. It now has the ability to communicate with God. It is now God conscious. But you still have the soul and the body that you and I have to contend with. Because these two components of that trichotomy, of that person, has not been awakened. The soul is self-conscious. It's aware of itself. And the body is conscious of the world in terms of its sensuality, the senses. It connects us to the world. So therefore, you have a corrupt nature that is still there, but yet at the same time, we are partaker of his divine nature. Then Paul, that is an agent, Paul that is an ambassador of the kingdom, he tells us that are a part of this vast body of Christ. If we ever intend to have a good showing with Christ, as the Apostle Paul says to Timothy, I have fought a good fight, I've what? Finished my course, and I've kept the faith. Then it means that there's something about the Christian now that has to be transformed. And that transformation tonight, my brothers and sisters, is our mind. And we look at mind. Well, mind certainly means it's that place that we receive data. It has to change. So he's really saying the old way of thinking has to be changed if we ever intend to be what God would have us to be in the confines of this new environment called the church or the ecclesia. Can we say praise the Lord? Why do some Christians, put your seatbelt on when I say this, why do some Christians have an extraordinary rough time? They're in a new environment, but their mindset has not changed. Now, if you follow me tonight, I gave reference to two things. There's an old corrupt nature that we have by birth. It's with us. It's attached to us. And because of the spiritual birth, we have what? A new nature, and it is attached to us. We are partakers, our part of that nature of Christ that is in us, all right? But I want you to think about a third component. And this is what Paul says in Romans chapter 8. And that component is carnality. Am I talking loud enough? Carnality is that person that has been born again. They've been baptized in Jesus' name. They've been baptized with the Holy Ghost. They speak in tongues. But it's something about that individual that they have not caught on yet. That third component is carnality. Can we say praise the Lord? It's found in Romans chapter 8 and started around verse 7. It's not subject, and the Bible says, neither indeed can be. Right? He is not talking about the pre-conversion. He's talking about those individuals that have known Christ at the Christ, but they have not walked in the Spirit, as Paul says in Galatians chapter 5 in verses 16 through 19. What I'm saying tonight. For Paul gave reference, he says, now, if you walk in the Spirit, you shall not fulfill what? He says the lust, but it means the desires of the flesh. Now, who was he talking to? He was not talking to individuals that did not have Christ. He was talking to individuals that were in Christ, but he was talking to individuals that did not have that transformed mind. They were in a spiritual community, that being the church, and that being the visible and invisible church, but they were walking as if they had never been born again. And as a result of that, they suffered the consequences. So tonight, my brothers and sisters, as we talk about the transformed mind and why people do or behave the way they do, it's because of three particular things. The corrupt nature, the new nature, and the carnal mind. Carnal mind is a fleshly mind. Carnal, carnivorous, flesh. And it thinks of the things of the flesh rather than the things of the Lord. Can we say praise the Lord? A non-Christian possesses no other nature but that corrupt nature. The only nature can be manifest through the personality. It's manifest in their behavior. When they confront problems, they only assess a solution separate from God. When there's a decision that needs to be made, God is not in the decision. When there's a conflict that needs resolution, they do not consult the Lord. Let me throw this scripture in here that I love so well, and it comes to us from the pen of Solomon, and it's Proverbs chapter 3. In verse 5, 6, and 7a. The writer says, trust in the Lord. Or we have confidence. We have the assurance in a God that cannot lie. There's no shadow of turning in him. Trust in the Lord. Now, this is as strong a commandment as any other one. Trust in the Lord. And if we trust in the Lord, he said, well, what? We will not lean to our own understanding. Someone said, what you lean to, you fall to. He says, acknowledge in all thy ways, acknowledge the Lord, and he will do what? He said, he will. Look at this now. Look at this. He will. We don't have to worry about it. This is something that he has promised us that he is going to do. And we certainly know that God cannot lie. When a Christian is not walking in the Spirit, this is also the only nature which can be manifest. And that is that old nature or that carnal nature. Every Christian has a new nature, which is expressed in and through their personality. I said that last week. However, the new nature is the life of Christ living in them by the indwelling of the Holy Ghost. This means that the Holy Ghost lives inside of us. Paul tells us in 1 Corinthians chapter 3, I believe, that your body is the temple of the Holy Ghost. This means that God's Spirit lives inside of those that have the new spirit. Its nature is like Christ. It characterized by his love rather than living for self. Hear what I'm saying tonight. Living for self, that's that old nature. The old nature wants immediate gratification. It wants attention, right? It wants to be right all the time. It wants to pursue its own endeavor, that old nature. It's in you, it's in me. And if we do not have anything that we can overcome that, then it leads and guides us, directs us at any path. Don't raise your hand. Have you ever done something, you wonder why you did it, and you wish you hadn't done it? Don't raise your hand. I'm going to raise mine. I'm putting my foot up too. But this is that old nature. Now, keep in mind, the old nature will still haunt you until you meet Jesus in that heavenly bliss. The new nature lives for Christ. The new nature lives for Christ. Now, what does that mean? It means it lives to do the right thing. It lives to follow the path that God has given us. Jesus made a statement in his earthly ministry. He says, I always do those things that is pleasing to the Father. Now, because you have that new nature, you've repented, you've been baptized in his name, been filled with the person, power of the Holy Spirit, evident speaking in tongues, now you can do what God says you can do. Put your seatbelt on. You can have what God says you can have. Am I talking loud enough? You don't have to live in depression and anxiety and trepidation. Can we say praise the Lord again? All right. In living for Christ, in the dwelling Holy Spirit produces in each Christian, hear what I'm saying now, something produces in each and every one of us. There's something inside of us that enables us to be successful in our lives. The pressures do not knock us out. The temptation does not overcome us. Hear what I'm saying tonight. The indwelling Holy Spirit produces in each Christian 9 spiritual attributes. My. Look at your neighbor and say, God put something in me. I'm going to hold on to it. Can't we say praise the Lord? Take time to read Galatians 5 and 22 and 23. But he's put something inside of us. He says love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, and temperance. He's put enough inside of us to hold us together when we otherwise would come unglued, fall apart. He put enough in us to still rejoice when things around us seem or just falling down on us. Like we got the whole world on our shoulders, we can still rejoice. My God. We trust in him because he has said to us, I will never leave you. Isn't that something? Some folks get upset and get tired. Man, I'm tired. I'm out here. We can trust the Lord. I will never leave you. Listen, never is a long time. My God. Now, you know what? Let's examine this for just a few seconds. When he says, I'll never leave you, I won't forsake you, in other words, he was saying that I'm going to always be there. Is that right? Well, let's hold on a minute. What he's trying to convey to us, if we can cognitively grab a hold of that, he is trying to tell us that if anything happens in the relationship, I'm not the one that's going to violate it. Something. Whatever you do, you have to do it. Because I'm the one that's going to be faithful and have fidelity. You can always trust me. You can always count on me. I know those of you and myself going through some rough times in life, that you need a shoulder to lean on. You need someone that's capable to give you the resources that you perhaps do not have. And the Lord says that even when you have those intrusive thoughts that come to your mind and you say, my God, where did they come from? That old nature that you thought was dead now becomes active in your life. And God says, I still won't leave you. Isn't that something? He is saying, if the contractual agreement is going to be fractured, he's saying, you have to do it. My God, my God. I'll be there in times of plenty. I'll be there in your lean times. I'll be there when you don't know what to do. Will comfort you. I'll be the one that will talk to your spirit in the midnight. I'll be the one that will whisper in your ear. I won't leave you. My God, my God. And you know what? Get this now. Hold on now. Hold on now. If the Spirit of Christ is in us, it means that we have the same demeanor. We have the same mindset because it's in us. We can't be short with folks. Now, why is our mindset transformed? It's transformed because Jesus now resides in us. You ever catch yourself being short with somebody and now you're quick to apologize? My. That person that gets on your last nerve. I think somebody can identify with it tonight. And brother, you're not the only one. When your mind begins to think contrary and crazy, if you will, you have the power to say, wait a minute. I'm not going down that road. Why? Because the Spirit of God is inside of you. And hear what I'm saying now. That's Jesus. And he was a master of his body. He was a master of. He was tempted just like you and I, but without sin. Therefore, it is extremely important within a marriage. To operate under the auspices of the Holy Spirit because God is in you. I'm not talking 99. Oh, my. You do what the Word says do. You're no longer operating on your old self, that old nature. I'm not talking 99. Pastor Frazier, don't get my business. Listen, if you're in the church and living according to the will of God and the Word, the Lord will get in your business. He will knock on your door. Am I talking loud enough? The problem is, my brothers and sisters, that we don't want him in our business. Isaiah 29 and verse 13. I would ask that you read, not right now, don't read it now, but at a time of leisure. He gets in our business, and since he is in us, since we avail him, us, our complete trichotomy, he is in us, he can do whatever he wants to do. Well, keep in mind, when the devil's in you, he done what he wanted to do. Jesus told him, said, John 8 and 38 and 44, he said, the lust of your father you will do. Jesus said, I always do the will of my father. Since he's in us, this means that we do his will. Now, not only do we do his will, but his will must be observable. We must be able to see when the difficulties of life come, I don't collapse. When things don't go my way, I don't give up. When the sun is not shining and it seems like the cloud always following me, I don't quit. Because I know weeping may endure for a night, but joy cometh in the morning. I don't live by my emotions. I don't live by my feelings anymore. There's a power inside. There's an authority there that makes this body behave when it wants to cut up. Because what? He's transforming my mind. Can we say praise the Lord? It's important for the family. God was the He instituted the family. He's a greater family. He said, be fruitful and multiply. This certainly comes through family. And we certainly know the first family had problems. Genesis chapter 4. But he also tells us, reminds us, when we transform our mind, put the seatbelt on down. Just like General Motors, he puts a manual in the automobile. You buy the automobile and never think about the manual until something goes wrong. You are a part of the body of Christ, and you have a manual. It's called the Bible, from Genesis chapter 1, Revelation chapter 2. It is something that allows you to troubleshoot. There is an answer. There is a solution for every problem. But the key thing, we go back to Isaiah chapter 29 and verse 13. There is a decision that he'll make for you if we consult him. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and all his righteousness, all these things shall be added unto you. Cast all your cares upon him, for he cares for you. There is a resolution for every conflict, but it is the transformation of our mind. Am I talking loud enough? The reason why we have so much pain and so much difficulty is because of Isaiah chapter 29, verse 13. Oh, I'm saying it so much. I know you think about what does that say? Oh, can't we say praise the Lord? But I don't want you to go there right now. You can write it down, but I don't want you going there right now. See, because some things I'll say that you'll write that down and say, I got to find out what that means. So in marriage and in family and also what? Church. Church setting is not immune from problems, decisions, and conflict. Loud enough. The church, the primitive church of 30 AD, not what we say AD, 30 circa, they had problems. And they had to come together to talk about the problems they had with the Jews, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. They had problems. Chapter 11, as folks got drunk in the church. I'm talking loud enough. They had a whole lot of problems. Why is that? Because their minds were not what? Transformed. They were still operating under the old regime, rather than having that new mindset. Can't we say praise the Lord again? Churches have problems. Marriages have problems. Families have problems. Church have problems. Because they will not yield themselves to the will and purpose of the eternal God. Yield means give right away. Understand these spiritual attributes help to transform our mind. You know, when you are very upset about something, it's very difficult for you to rely upon God's word. And you want things to happen very rapidly. That old cliche that folks say in church, he may not come when you want him, but he's... Oh, y'all heard that I said that. Look at the reality of what you're saying. He may not come when you want him. I want him to come when I want him. If I'm in trouble, and I say, Jesus. Well, I'm not coming right now. I'll come next week. Is the present what? Bye. This means our mind has to be what? Transformed. Our spiritual attributes are like a pair of eyeglasses. You've heard the old statement, they're looking through rose glasses. Or they see the world through what? Do you follow what I'm saying? This means when your mind is changed, you see the world differently. You understand what's going on. And this is the thing that gives you peace, because now you understand that nothing takes God by surprise. You understand now whatever God is doing is for our benefit. And we say, praise the Lord again. All things work together. This means we need to stop quoting these scriptures if we don't believe them. Our spiritual attributes are like a pair of eyeglasses we put on. All of life is seen through the lens of these glasses, are these spiritual attributes. Nobody loves me. Jesus loved you so much he died on the cross of Calvary. I don't have joy. The Bible said the joy of the Lord is our strength. Peace. He has peace that surpasses what? All understanding. I'll keep you. What? I'll keep you. Look what he says. I'll keep you. I'll keep you in perfect peace. Minds are stayed what? On me and trusted in me. Great peace have they that love thy law, and nothing shall what? Offend thee. The question might be, how do you see? You hear what I'm saying now? We've got glasses, but how do you see? How do you see? How do you see your life? How do you see your life? Some folks think they're underappreciated. Am I talking loud enough? God says what? I'll exalt you where? He said, in due season, due time. All of us have to go through something. Irregardless as to where it is, marriage, family, children, church, workplace, community, spouse, children. But how do you see that? Do you see it through the glasses of spiritual attributes? Are you still looking at yourself and the world and the difficulties around you, the challenges, through the eyes of corrupt nature? It makes your life miserable. Miserable marriage, miserable family, miserable church. Call you Mr. and Mrs. Miserable. Go to the restaurant. May I help you? A party of one. The spirit of me. Live a life where the person is always a victim. God has set you free. If we want to be effective saints, spouses, parents, ambassadors, we must remember that we are looking through spiritual eyeglasses. We don't see the same thing the world sees. You know, when I watch some of these programs, I like them on TV, where they renovate these houses. I'm thinking, said, my goodness, why did you purchase that house for that much money? It looks like it's ready to fall apart. But someone sees beyond what they see. Am I talking loud enough? They see something there before it ever materializes. Don't you know God sees you that way? You have to see victory before victory even comes into your life. Peace of mind. This is how those operate in this new environment with a transformed mind. Can we say hallelujah? My. We must remember that we are looking through spiritual eyeglasses, because our mind has been what? Transformed. You know, sometimes people want to bring you back. Gary, you remember when? Man, I don't want to talk about that. Man, I knew Frazier when. So what? God is dealing with you and I in where? The here and the now. Well, you know what? Well, listen, what you've done in 1942, that don't count today. It's now. Your salvation is based now, where you are now, not where you hope to be. It's now. The day you hear his voice, harden not your heart. Because our mind has been what? Transformed. We no longer operate under the corrupt nature. Got a new sign on new management. Under new management. Because the Apostle Paul states, Romans 8, 7 through 13. I'm reading this out of the God's Word translation. This is so because the corrupt nature has a hostile attitude toward God. It refuses to place itself under the authority of God's standard because it can't. Those who are under the control of the corrupt nature can't please God. But if God's Spirit lives in you, you are under the control of your spiritual nature, not your corrupt nature. Whoever doesn't have the Spirit of Christ doesn't belong to him. Now, that's not Pastor Frazier, that's the Bible, but I believe. However, if Christ lives in you, your bodies are dead because of sin. Separated from sin is inactive of sin. But your spirits are alive because you have God's approval. Does the spirit of one who brought Jesus back to life live in you? Then the one who brought Christ back to life will also make your mortal bodies alive by the Spirit lives in you. So, brothers and sisters, we have no obligation to live the way our corrupt nature wants us to live. If you live by your corrupt nature, you are going to die. But if you use your spiritual nature to put to death the evil activities of the body, you shall live. And that is certainly a perpetual promise of the Lord conveyed to the Apostle Paul to the church community of baptized believers at Rome. Let us continue. One of the most common sins among Christians, stay with me now, is pride. You know what I'm saying now? Is pride. Why is it that someone can say something and it hurts like I don't know what? They never used a knife. They never bludgeoned you. Never used a gun. Now, I know many of us, we can remember those things years ago. Sticks and stones may break my bones, but words would never hurt me. Is that right? Words have started wars. What is it that pulls us out of our nature and causes us to behave in that old nature? It's pride. I'm assuming everyone should be like, what I'm saying, the pride is by saying what? Everyone should be like me. Or, I am right in the way I view things. Anyone disagrees with me is wrong. That is that old nature operating. We're supposed to be like Jesus. Conduct ourselves like Jesus. Can we say praise the Lord? The biblical truth is that God has purposed that we be very different from one another, but yet the same in Christ Jesus. We are to value each other as God has purposed. Now, once again, my brothers and sisters, this can only come when we have a transformed mind. I'm going to say a few things, and I'm going to give space of time for questions that you might have, if you have any. If we understand at this particular point, and we have been now able to make connections and put certain things together, it means that we have what? We have the corrupt nature with us, and we also have that new nature with us. And that new nature, John says, greater is he that what? That is within you than he that is in the world. Is that right? So this means that we have the ability, because we have been empowered, enabled by the Holy Spirit to make this body operate according to the Spirit that is inside of us. All right? So if I get angry, I get upset, and emotionally out, it's because I have not allowed the Spirit of God to operate in me. I have declared my own independence, and yet at the same time, I'm still a child of God. Are you still with me? What you do with your body and with your mind is up to you. But the Lord said, transform it. When I'm humiliated, I'm not to retaliate. I'm to step back and let what? The Lord said, vengeance is mine. I will what? Repay. How many times we sing that song? If I hold peace and let the Lord what? But keep in mind, most folks don't want to hold their peace. It's amazing what the Lord will do inside of us if we yield ourselves to Him. Why? Because the battle belongs to the Lord. Now you get in the battle, you don't know who's going to win. But the Lord promised, I'll fight your battle. And this only comes when our mindset is changed. You follow me? But, Pastor, does it change overnight? Not at all. Not at all. You have to go through some trials and some tests. You have to go through some yielding. And that pie that some folks talk about, they don't want to eat it, it's called humble pie. When you find yourself in a situation where it becomes a spiritual dilemma, step back and let the Lord handle it. You don't have to get upset. The Bible says, be angry and sin not. If you're angry, be angry with God is angry with. Don't let the sun go up. So all of these things that we have discussed tonight, my brothers and sisters, comes to this particular final point. You can never, and when I say never, a lot of times red flags ought to go up. You can never serve God. You could never hope to receive anything from God until you are transformed. The larger picture, I want you to get this tonight. The larger picture, if your mind is transformed, if your mind is transformed, everything else is. Why would he let any of us come into the kingdom and we have not been domesticated? You're still wild. You still have that old nature. There's a story in the scripture narrative about that man that had the legions, you recall that? And he lived in the tombs and cut himself and howled at night and unclothed. And nobody could, the Bible said they could not tame him. And what that meant, they could not domesticate him. This is what the Lord is trying to do to his people, that we come from the wild, come from being disobedient. And now we'll come to the kingdom of God. And he's trying to do what? Domesticate us. So that he can use us. But he can never use us until he transforms us. And as we grow, as we prosper in him, there will always be those things that pull on us. And he's making us aware that there are certain things that we need to be transformed. I'm going to stop here, my brothers and sisters. I certainly want to thank all of you for coming. But if you have a question, you can certainly take opportunity to raise your hand, and I'll make the attempt to address those particular questions. All right, Deacon, somebody get a microphone to him. Say it loud so our hearers on social media can hear as well. Say it loud, sir.
Praise the Lord, Bishop. Praise the Lord, Bishop.
Praise the Lord.
My question is this, to for a better understanding for me. You said that if our mind is transformed, everything else is transformed.
Yes.
So my question is, when you say everything else is transformed, is our circumstances, situations, and issues of life transformed as well?
No. Conditions remain the same, but you don't remain the same. I'm talking loud enough.
Amen.
You can have havoc in your home, but the Lord can give you peace of mind. I'm talking loud enough.
Amen.
He'll hold you in Christian character. You can have problems at the workplace, but the Lord will hold you in Christian character.
Amen.
Kids, children can cut up, They can do all kinds of things, and you still can walk in Christian care. You can love them. You can still pray for them. Am I talking loud enough? Somebody can treat you ill. You can still pray for them, and keep in mind, and mean it.
Amen.
And mean it. See, what happens, put your seatbelt on, I say this, my brothers and sisters. Many times what happens to us, we just need the Lord to knock the pride out of us. That's what he did to Paul.
Amen.
Who art thou, Lord? I think some of us need to say that as well. Who art thou, Lord? Well, I'm your peace. I'm your joy. I'm your stability. I'm your foundation. I'm your shelter. I'm your life. See?
Amen.
And when we find ourselves in opposition to God, the blessed thing to do, just throw your hands up and say, Lord, I'm just a rascal. I just need help. He's the one able to help us. If that is not true, then we have a problem with Matthew chapter 11. My yoke is easy and my burden is light. Listen, it's never easy when we're contending with God.
Amen.
He's our Savior. He's not for us to battle. The whole duty of man is what?
To fear God and keep his commandments.
It's to reverence God and do his will. We are the agents, the ambassadors. Look at that model prayer. Thy what?
Will be done.
Where?
On earth that it is in heaven.
Yes. And we're the one to do that, to further that. Anytime we find ourselves not aligning with God's word, we're stepping in front of God. We're telling God, I can do it better than you. We have to learn, as hard and as difficult it is, to stay behind the cross.
Amen.
Well, Pastor Frazier, it hurts. It always hurts when you're not accustomed to doing something. Then we say, praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
And that's what he's going to reward us for. Is there another hand tonight? I will. All right, we got two hands here. Deacon Brooks. And all right, I'm glad you clarified that.
Yes, sir. Before I was born again, I was on drugs and cocaine.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't have any willpower. You understand what I'm saying?
Yes, sir.
When people would come to me with marijuana or crack or liquor, I didn't have any. I just would get high. But once I was born again, I had something inside me. And I had a situation where I had a former drug dealer came to my house. And he said, well, I got $100 worth of crack right here. Before I was born again, I would have broke out the pipe and started smoking with him. Mm-hmm. But once I was born again, I had that power inside me that said, no, I'm not going to do that. I'm not going to go back to that lifestyle. Mm-hmm. You understand what I'm saying? So
yes, sir.
Being transformed really means something. When you have the power of the Holy Ghost in you, it makes a big difference. That's just like when I was a kid, they had a cartoon named Popeye the Sailor Man.
Mm-hmm.
And then, you know, Popeye went through a lot. But once he opened that can of spinach, he had that power inside of him. And that's what being transformed again. That's what I had to
All
say.
Right. Deacon Brooks, I was at a church meeting. And one gentleman was testifying that he was on crack and he was on drugs and he just never thought that his life would change. He said, I thank God because not only did I meet Christ, but he met me and changed my life and transformed me. And the people got just happy. He said, wait a minute. Look here on the front seat. That's the drug dealer, and he's saved too. Don't you tell me what God cannot do. All he wants is a heart that he can plant his word in. A soul that will believe it. Now, hear what I'm saying. Not only for that time, but for eternity. Elder Arnett, you have a question, sir.
He said, hold our peace and let the Lord fight our battles. Like, for people out there in the world, you know, they can say stuff, but it don't faze you. Mm-hmm. But when it comes from inside the church, or inside the family, that's when it hurts. Mm-hmm. So how do we deal with situations like that when it comes from somebody that's close to you or somebody inside the church that you look up to?
Well, I wish I had Brother Job here tonight. He had three friends. He was in a deplorable condition, attacked by the enemy from the crown of his head to the soles of his feet. And he told them, they came to him, they called themselves comforted. He said, you are physicians of no value. His trust and confidence is in the Lord. You see, so often we want something that we can't get, and we want people to do something that they won't do. But the Bible tells us, he that hungers and thirsts after righteousness, he shall be what? Filled. That connotation means to be satisfied. Jesus Christ is the only one that satisfies the soul. We look for justification. We look for people to treat us right. They may not. But the Lord always will. And since we are a child of God, we have to live above these things. And he enables us to do so. And always understand, in families, they may not be progressing at the same level that you are. The wonderful thing we do like this, but that is unreasonable. So we have to take our burdens to the Lord and what?
Leave them there.
Now, hear what I'm saying. Leave it there. You know what he told us? Peter says this in 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 7. Cast all of your cares upon him, for he careth for you. Now, we understand that from an intellectual standpoint, but he wants us to understand that as a spiritual standpoint and as a son and a daughter in Christ. The key thing is, how do I do that? How do I free my mind from what somebody has said that hurt me? And most of the time, I'm not saying everybody, most of the time, what's hurt is pride. I dare you to say to me, who are you? And limited times, it's God dealing with us so we can go up a little higher. Am I talking loud enough?
Amen.
Before we conclude this life, this journey, there's a whole lot of things that God is trying to get out of us so he can get completely in us. God changes us. God transforms us. And I said something, and I want to make an impact on that. God can never use us until he transforms us. Am I talking loud enough? I say this in church, and I don't say it to hurt anybody, but I say this in church. Until we learn how to come to church and praise and magnify God, we haven't done nothing. Until the preacher preaches and lives are transformed and teaches, we haven't done anything. We can say that I'm a child of God, I'm this, that, and the other, but until your mind is transformed, you are not. You are still walking in carnality. I'm talking loud enough. Things happen not because God is unaware, but things happen to make us. Am I talking loud enough? When somebody just pulls right in front of you, what happens? Do you get a certain feeling that comes over you? At the grocery store or at the mall, when somebody does something, anything rises up in you? Well, I want to tell you, keep in mind, that's that old nature. letting you know, I'm still alive, I'm still here. And old nature wants to cuss them out. Old nature wants to put, old nature wants to bite them. But you have the power over it because the Holy Ghost is inside of you. You see, it's not wrong to be tempted. It's wrong what? Jesus was tempted. You still think about that cold beer, but you don't go to the store and buy it. She still looks good and curvy. He still looks good, tall, dark, and handsome, and head full of hair. But you don't take him home. Am I talking loud enough? Because you have God inside of you, and you have decided to make Jesus your choice. I thought I saw a hand over here. Did I see a hand over here? Oh, bless your heart. I guess we'll stop here. Well, I certainly want to say tonight, I'm certainly happy that those of you that felt the auspice of the Lord and you're here tonight, hope we have said something to encourage you and to help you. And certainly those of you that are on our social media, thank God for you as well. It is a time, to evaluate us. It's a time when you feel that old nature rising up. God is allowing you to say, this thing must die. It must die. And that old nature will always present itself in your body. Whoever is in control, your spirit, talks to your body will do whatever it's told. But when you're transformed, you recognize something. You say, uh-oh, this is not the Lord, this is not the Lord. I don't want to do anything that will cause him grief. I will not grieve the Holy Spirit. Can we say praise the Lord again? Certainly happy to see Brother McNair in our midst tonight. Amen. See you soon. Amen. All right. Want to say to those on the social media, hit that chat sometime, a little box, and we will try to address some of the questions that you might have as well. We thank God that you've taken out of your time to be with us tonight, and certainly ask God's blessing upon those of you that are here. Can we say praise the Lord again? If you are excited about what God has done for you, then share that excitement with someone else. And we're certainly happy for Sister Bell, Barry, rather, Sister Barry. Amen. Receiving baptism and receiving the Holy Ghost on Sunday. I think I cut my step a little bit too. Amen. Self is rejoicing over one soul, and we ought to be excited as well. Can't we say praise the Lord? All right, let us stand. Thank the sisters for singing last Sunday, and I hope that inspires some of the brothers to come and start soon some singing. Dr. Morgan. Praise the Lord. Say it loud, if you will. Amen. Well, they're not all here tonight, so I don't know how we could have the old count, but you all do the best you can. Yes. Amen. And that's a commitment. I think it's good for the sisters to go out. Maybe you inspire the brothers. Can't we say praise the Lord? Elder Florin, you give us the benediction tonight, sir. Lord, we thank you, oh God, for your power, your might, the spirit of truth. We pray, oh God, touch the heart of your people. Give us strength, give us grace. We pray, oh God, do a new thing in our midst. Help us, oh God, to humble ourselves, oh God, before you. Change our heart, our mind. When you change it, you change our direction, change our outlook. We pray, oh God, for the sick and the infirm. We pray for the lost, the backslidden. Take time to shake someone's hand and say, praise the Lord, we're certainly happy to see you.